Okay, we're live. Hello, everybody. This is going to be an amazing little show we put together here for you. We're doing this on behalf of the Arcanum.com, and I know most of you watching live know what that is, but people who are watching it later might not, so I'll just tell you real briefly what's going on. So it's a completely new way to learn photography and art. And there's something kind of, I think, special. The masters that are here today and all the masters that are part of the first group that's launching the Arcanum, we all know how important art and creative processes are in our lives and how we can't even imagine our life without art and creativity. And so we want to bring this gift or enhance this gift in, you know, thousands, tens of thousands of people around the world. And so the way the Arcanum works is, as opposed to maybe like a lynda.com, for example, where you go and you just pay money and then you just have access to thousands and thousands of videos, we're totally different because we're a human-based network based on the very ancient tradition style of masters and apprentices. So you actually have a real human that's guiding you down your own personal artistic path. And so we want to do a little event right now just to kind of you know, keep everybody excited. We're super excited inside. We're currently doing a lot of internal testing, and so we're figuring out all these little moving parts. But in the meantime, I want to take a break from all that hard work and have this sort of fun critique session. All right, so Pete Giordano, who's one of the many monkeys that's helping me run helping me run this operation. Pete, why don't you just jump in and we'll go around for introductions. We can see who's joined us and talk about our day together here.
Right on. Excellent. Thanks, Trey. Well, why don't we go ahead and start from with Dave?
Hello.
Yeah, there you go. Right on. Can you go ahead and introduce yourself? Say a little something about yourself?
Sure. My name is Dave Cross, and since 1990, I taught my first Photoshop class 2 weeks after it came out, and I haven't stopped since. So I'm first and foremost a Photoshop educator, also a passionate photographer, so teach Photoshop and photography and have my own studio / workshop center here in Tampa, Florida, although I am formerly from Canada and a proud Canadian. Go hockey.
Excellent, thanks. And Varina, how about you?
Yeah, I am a landscape photographer. I've been working with Photoshop since 1994. I went pro as a photographer in 2005. I spent the first half of January in Australia this year, teaching a workshop down there and preparing a course that actually just came out today. So, you know, that's my big thing that we've been working on right now and that we're pretty excited about. And so I teach workshops, I teach video courses, and I have a series of ebooks that my husband and I wrote together. And so our business is really about teaching, and that's how we make our money.
You're a professional, consummate professional.
That's right. It's the best job in the world, I think.
Right on. All right, Rick, you're up.
Well, first of all, thanks, guys, for having me. I'm really happy to be part of the Arcanum. I think it's really cool. I like the whole apprentice master thing, and I think Trey invited me into this because they need an old master. So I think I might be the oldest master. Is that right, Trey?
Well, we're not keeping score. It's, you know, the number of times you've been around the sun seems an arbitrary number, but maybe.
But all kidding aside, you know, I tell people that my specialty is not specializing because, you know, like you, I like to do it all. I like to do the people. I like to do the landscape. I like to do the travel, the HDR, EDR, extended dynamic range. So I like to make learning fun, and I think that's one of the things that is great about the Arcanum. I think it's going to be fun, and I say if you're not having fun, you're doing something wrong.
Yeah. Right on. All right. Well, thank you, guys. And Trey, I don't know if you want to say anything else, or we can jump right into some of the event overview. How's that?
Yeah. Why don't you tell people what they're going to see today, and then I'll share some screens and give them some bonus goodies that they might not know about yet.
Okay. Well, as everybody knows, Trey mentioned, we announced the Arcanum several weeks ago, and like as Trey likes to say, all the little elves, this time he said monkeys, but most of the time it's about the elves that are feverishly working to get the doors of this magical academy wide open. And so in the meantime, we thought it would be great if we could give everyone a little taste of just one of the many benefits that folks are going to have when they join the Arcanum. Trey talked about that human-to-human connection and being guided on a personalized path. And so one of those elements is really something that we think is really lacking out there in the universe, and that is really good constructive criticism. And so we went out on a limb, and we created an event and asked all of our applicants, so we've had thousands of folks applied to the Arcanum, and we sent them an email and also opened this event up to the public. And the whole premise is these public people and these folks that have been so kind to sign up for the Arcanum have submitted hundreds and hundreds of photos.
And so, something that we think is really lacking out there in the universe.
Hey, Rick, you might want to turn that off. It's getting a little feedback.
And so we went out on a limb, and we created an event and asked all of our applicants. So we've had thousands of...
It's okay. I muted him, Pete. Go on.
Perfect. Thank you. No problem. Yeah. So what I was about to say was, of all these folks, they've really just made us feel so humble because they've gone out on a limb. They've submitted hundreds and hundreds of photos to be critiqued by these professionals that we have. We're so happy to have Dave and Varina and Rick as just a few of our many masters in the Arcanum, and they have been working with us to design a wonderful system that everybody will enjoy in the Arcanum. But today, they've gone ahead and picked out, I know it had to be a challenge, but they've picked out one photo each. And today, live, they're going to do a short critique on each of those photos, and if they're feeling a little frisky, some of them may even take a few minutes and do a little post-processing on them to just coax some of the greatness out of these photos. So I want to reiterate what Trey said, which is thank you so much to everybody for, number one, applying into the Arcanum, being part of the audience, submitting your photos. We're so sorry that we can't go ahead and critique every one of them, but we'll be doing many more of these events, and one of these days I know your photo will get up there. So. All right, with that, how about if we talk a little bit about how the event's going to roll, all right? So what we'll do is in a round-robin fashion, we'll start with Rick and then go to Varina and then Dave and then finally Trey. And for each of these Arcanum Masters, they'll take a moment to introduce the photographer and the photo that they've selected, talk a little bit about a critique, two or three or four points of constructive criticism. And then, like I said, if they're feeling frisky, they'll go ahead and open it up in Lightroom or Photoshop or whatever their photo editing app is of their choice, and again, coax some more of that greatness out of the image. Okay. And then, in the meantime, if there are questions, we'll be looking at those in the event, in the chat on the event page in Google+, and we'll do a little bit of Q&A, and then we'll close it all down at the end. Hopefully, we'll be out of here in about an hour or so. Sound good?
Yeah, it does sound good. I'm looking over here on my other monitor at all the chat that's going by in the event. It's unbelievable. People are tuning in from all over the world. It's super, super exciting. We're honored.
Hello from India right away.
So, to reiterate what you just said about people being excited, also we really want to thank everyone for your patience because we're actually building something that's never been built before. So there's a lot of technology infrastructure. There's a lot of things we have to test logistically as to the progression of the levels, so on and so forth. And I can promise you one thing is that we're going to be making a lot of mistakes and learning together. We'll consider this whole first year to be sort of a beta period. But we have too many smart people involved at the master level and behind the scenes so that it's almost impossible this won't be successful. It's just going to take some time to roll out and replicate this meme out, so that we can take care of thousands, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of people. But this is going to work just fine. We'll do some iteration. So I want to share some things and give people some secret kind of behind-the-scenes stuff here that you'll like about the Arcanum. So this is the page that we announced for people that are just watching this on the raw, don't know anything about it, and we asked people to submit photos. And I haven't asked the other masters, but I clicked on just about every one of these photos. And there's way more that we could critique. It's ridiculous. But these are like really nice people. They say nice things, and they give links to their art. And frankly, some of the stuff I clicked on, I couldn't possibly critique because it was so good already. I was just so impressed at the time. And this is just one place. We also have this something of a similar length over on Facebook. So anyway, we picked some of these at random to critique. Now, this is a sneak preview of what the Arcanum is about to look like. Probably in the next week or two, we're rolling out this new UI that I think is absolutely gorgeous. So this is the application. This is what the application looks like when you sign up. And actually, you kind of keep your application live the whole time. It becomes part of your sort of apprentice profile. And like you start to add other things to it over time, like you add photos that you're going to be critiqued. So almost like a student record kind of thing. But everything in the Arcanum is going to have this sort of glossy look to it. And while this is up, this application is up, let me encourage people to make sure you fully fill out your application, because when masters go through and choose you, like, you'll be personally chosen by a Varina or a Dave or a Rick or all these other great masters. You know, we look at these individually, and we'll see, like, well, why do they want to join? What do they really want to learn? Examples of your work. And don't worry if your examples of your work aren't good. You know, we just... I think one thing that all of us really like to work with is total beginners. So don't be afraid about that. And then the last thing is this. If you hunt around on the Arcanum website, you'll see this thing. It's a leveling guide. So this kind of shows the first 10 levels that you achieve inside the Arcanum, and your master will take you through this, you know, sort of be a mentor as you go through these levels. And what happens is every 5 levels, there's a critique, okay? So at levels 5, 10, 15, 20, you actually get a one-on-one critique with your master, and it'll be recorded just like this on YouTube, and the critique will be available for everyone to watch inside the Arcanum. And I love watching critiques personally, and I think I'll just sit there and watch critiques all day long. I'll just have the nonstop Arcanum critique channel just flying by. Even people not of my discipline, I still want to see other disciplines out there. And so what we do in the critique, just for example, and you can come read this at your leisure, I won't be all pedantic now, but this is the evaluation of photos. And it gets harder and harder at subsequent levels to pass the critique. So for example, at level 5, you have to take in 7 photos. And they are rated, you know, you get feedback on all of them, but they ultimately get some sort of a rating. Either it's below average, it shows promise, it's commendable, or exemplary. Right, and if you have, like at level 5, for example, if you have 5 that show promise and 2 that are commendable, then you'll pass it, and you'll get to go on to the next level. But it'll get harder and harder. You'll have to have higher and higher ratings as you go on. So anyway, that is that. Let me unscreen share. Okay, now we jump right into it. Pete, who's up for critiques?
I think what we're going to do is start with Rick.
Sure.
Right on.
Well, I'm ready. So first of all, let me go to a screen sharing here. And desktop, start screen share. And I think I'm screen sharing. You guys can see this now?
Yes.
Okay. Perfect. So before I get going here, this is what I want to say. Did you guys see the Beatles special last night on CBS?
No.
No?
No,
I missed it. I saw the Beatles special? Anyway, this was amazing. Paul McCartney was there, Ringo was there. Anyway, every group, they had all these guest artists performing there. My wife and I thought everyone was great. So we read a review in the paper today, says, oh, this artist wasn't that good, this artist wasn't, you know, blah, blah, blah. They're putting down a lot of the artists. All this is subjective. So I think that's true with all types of art. So what I'm going to say about this great photo by Chris McKay is, you know, this is subjective. These are just some things that I would do. We could criticize every picture that Ansel Adams took, every Beatles song or whatever. And this old Trey and I were talking about this before, that there's a lot in common between music and photography. So I want to start with this photo by Chris. First of all, I've never been there. It looks like a nice place that I want to go. So, I said to Chris down here that it's a beautiful image. I'm going to play with that. So this is what I'm going to do. I have this picture loaded in Lightroom. And some of my friends who are watching this might be surprised. I told someone today that I think I use Dave Cross and I. And Dave, correct me if I'm wrong, I think you and I are the only people that we know who use Photoshop more than Lightroom. Is that true?
Well, that's probably true to some extent, although I hear that more and more that people do. They're not part of the 80% Lightroom crowd. So I think there's a place for both.
And I got to admit, I don't use Lightroom at all. So,
well, I'm using Lightroom just for something different. So anyway, this is what I like about about the photo. First of all, I love the feeling of this like arch here. So I'm looking around here. So this picture has some movement to it. You can see where I'm moving my cursor. I like the waves over here. I like the rocks. I like the clouds. But the first thing I do always with the picture is I crop my picture, because cropping gives us a second chance at composition. Edward Weston said that composition is the strongest way of seeing, and I really believe that. You know, as photographers, you know, Trey talks about this all the time, and as artists, we see the world differently. So I think this is one of the really cool things about being a photographer. So cropping gives us a second chance at that, at the composition. So the first thing I do is crop. So I'm going to, as much as I like this sky, I think this is the main subject down here. I was playing around, taking off a little sky, a little more. So I took this much sky off, but then I see the horizon line is in the middle. Now, one of the rules of composition is, in landscape photography, don't place the horizon line in the center of the photograph. Well, here's what I say about that. I didn't write the rules of composition. Why the heck should I follow them? And I think that, you know, as photographers, there are a lot of rules about composition, rules about lighting, rules about this and that. Break the rules. I'm not saying this is the best composition for this. I'm just giving you an example of a different crop. Also, I like the crop maybe because I watch, movies and HDTV. I like this type of format. So I can undo it, but I'm going to leave it here. But this is my main thing with the, actually, this is my main thing with the picture. The highlights are a little overexposed and washed out. When I shoot, if you look over here at the histogram, the chant on my workshops is check the histogram and make sure your highlight alert is on and expose for the highlights. Because if you made a print of this picture, this might be as white as the paper, and back here, we lost some detail. Oh, let me go back to what I like about this picture. I forgot. I feel like I'm there. I think the photographer might have been down a little low, and I think having those foreground elements there are great. Plus, when I shoot a landscape, when I shoot a seascape, I want it to look as it looks to my eyes. Everything in the scene in focus. I could see, you know, the pebbles in the foreground, sharp focus. I could see the mountains in the background in sharp focus. So I think he did a great job on getting everything in the focus, and I really like the composition. I just cropped it that way to illustrate the point. The other thing that we have to think about is when we publish a picture, is do what we call border patrol, to run our eyes around the border to make sure there are no elements in there that we don't want. We want to think like a painter. If we think like a painter, we'll start to, you know, painting is additive, photography is subtractive. Basically, although painters do add what's on the canvas. So we want to subtract stuff. So I subtracted it, but by doing border patrol, you'll see, you know, when you miss some like dust spots. But again, the main thing is the highlights. So I'm going to go over here, and if I just reduce my exposure, you can see the histogram change. The picture to me, and again, you know, my wife Susan likes pictures a little on the light side. I like pictures a little on the dark side. The main thing in a picture, any picture, is the mood, is the feeling, it's the emotion. So to me, having a picture, well, I should turn off my email so I don't get any more emails during the little session there, is the feeling. So I think having the picture a little darker is a little more of a mood to it. Again, this is just me. So I'm going to tone down my highlights here. I'm going to tone down the whites. So to me, this picture has more of a mood. I would like to see a little more of these boulders here. So I'm going to open up the shadows just a little bit. You know, we open up too much, you know, now we see what they look like. But I think by doing that, just like with HDR, HDR is great, as Trey knows and everyone knows, but it can destroy the mood, the feeling, the emotion of the scene. So I'm going to do that. And I love playing with the blacks, making the blacks just a little blacker. Open up the shadows, and might tone down the whites. Now, no matter how far I tone these down, as you can see, the highlights are still a little overexposed and washed out. So this is why, my friends, I really recommend exposing for the highlights if you're doing a single image. Now, that said, you know, you see fashion pictures where, you know, the background's all blown out. That's fine too. One other thing I might do here, you know, everyone's into like super sharp pictures, you know, they want to sharpen this and that. Because he did such a good job blurring this water, I might use a slightly slower shutter speed, but he did a good job. I might reduce the clarity just a little more. So if you want a straight print, that's what I would do. How am I doing on time, Peter?
I gave you the thumbs up. You're doing great.
Okay. Do I have a few more minutes?
Sorry, you got screen share. Sorry. Yeah, you got a few minutes for sure.
Okay. Then what I would do, okay, if you want a straight shot, you know, this is okay over here. To me, that looks a little more dramatic. But again, you haven't lost this beautiful arc here, the feeling of the water. I feel like I'm there. Actually, it's so cold out, I really wish I were there. Maybe that's why I picked this photo. But now I'm going to go to edit in one of my favorite plugins, Nick Color Effects Pro. I'm going to edit with the copy in Lightroom. Now, my friends who know me on my workshops are probably surprised that I'm doing this because they see me working in Photoshop all the time. Anyway, Darken, Lighten, Center came up because that's the last one I used. Ansel Adams said, a picture's not done until you darken the edges. Look at the Renaissance paintings, whether it's a portrait or a still life, most of the pictures have the edges darkened, if I compare here, and that draws your eye to the center, the masterpiece, or the centerpiece here, the boulders in the middle. It draws your eyes to these boulders. Now, if you're unfamiliar with this, you could click this little dot here, place the center anywhere you want. If you do it too much, it looks kind of fake. Okay, so here's like not using it. And actually, this doesn't look so bad. It might look a little more dramatic. But be careful. Don't overdo this. You could also change the size. So again, that's a pretty nice straight shot for maybe a more creative shot. You want to go... Whoops, I lost something here. Where did I go? I think I must have gotten out of that. Well, anyway, I don't want to take up all the time. I think that was a more creative shot Oh, wait, there we go. Now I know what I did. Whoops. And I got Trey back. I think I have to go to screen sharing. Is that right, Trey? Let me go back. I got out of screen sharing, right?
You're almost there.
I'm almost there. I'm doing
almost
screen
there.
Share.
Now you're back.
I'm back. I got to get this. I got to get my desktop screen share.
No, you're done. You're right. We saw you.
Okay, you saw. Okay, I'm done. There are other things we could do, but I'm going to cancel this, and I think that's enough. But again, the best thing is it's really, really a nice, picture.
All right. Who's up next, Pete?
Yep, Varina, I think you're next up. You're ready to
All
go.
All right. Yep, I'm ready to go. Decided to take a look at this photo. I'm going to share my screen here. Can you see that?
It's going to come up in a second, I think. Yes. There you go. You're up.
Okay, excellent. So it's this tiny little shot here by Israel Resendez, and I'm going to open it up for you. I found it on Facebook, and the title of his shot is Laguna de Zumpago, I think, in Mexico. Whether or not I said that correctly, I do not know, and I apologize if I messed it up. But to me, what really stood out about this image is that it has this very minimalist feel, which I love. I am a huge fan of minimalist photography. I just love that. And so to to find an image like this that's very simple. It's under-processed, in my opinion, which is actually kind of nice. I like to start with an image that's under-processed or not processed at all, so that was nice. But there was something else that really stood out to me, and that is the colors. What's happening here is that you have an analogous color scheme in the sky and the water. Analogous colors are side by side on the color wheel, so blues and greens. And what that does, with blues and greens, you get a very peaceful, very fresh feeling. So you have that here. But even better, this little boat that's floating in the water here, the complementary color for blue is gold. The complementary color for green is red, and so you've got these complementary colors on the boat sitting in the water here. And that makes the boat really pop out as a neat center of interest. So, a neat point of interest. So, there's a lot going for this photo. Now, there are some things that really need to be fixed here. First and foremost, I think most of us are going to notice right away that this horizon is tilted. That is something that needs to be fixed right away. There are some distractions that I want to get rid of, and I'm going to work through that in a second here. Also, I think the photo lacks impact as it stands, and I want to make sure that it has a little bit more impact. I want to make sure that I bring out the potential in this photo, and because it's such a beautiful minimalist scene, I'm going to see if I can use that to my advantage. Okay, so I'm going to start by fixing the tilt to this image, and at the same time, I'm going to crop it. So the reason I want to crop it is because of this corner right down here at the bottom right. To me, that's a very distracting element. It's not particularly appealing in the photo. It doesn't add anything to the photo. And if I cut that out and take it up right just past that to the edge of the clouds, I have a pretty neat image that is, again, as Rick said, I'm putting my horizon right in the center here, but I like it in the center. I make my rules, right? So I couldn't agree more with Rick on that. We get to make our own rules. And then, of course, I'm going to tilt the image here and make sure that it's lined up really neatly. And then that's going to be my crop. In fact, I'm going to crop it just a little bit more because I see that in the corner there I have a little bit of that brown still sitting there. Now, once it's cropped, the next step is to think about what the photo needs. And I mentioned that before. I'm going to do something about some contrast. And then I need to go in. I have some noise that I'm noticing here. And I want to do a little bit of cloning, mostly of this bright little spot right in the foreground. So let me start with contrast. Okay, I'm going to fill up my screen so this is as big as it can be. And then I use this little option right here and choose curves. I'm creating a curves layer so that I can turn it on and off, delete it if I want to, do whatever I want with that layer. A lot of times I'll reduce the opacity of a layer. But you can see all I've done is create a simple S curve. I'm brightening up the highlights, darkening the shadows, and if I turn that on and off, you can see right away the impact of the photo starts to be increased. It's starting to look much cleaner. It's starting to look a little bit more like a professional photo instead of a snapshot. Okay, so that's such a simple little change there. Now, a lot of times, another option is to copy and paste that layer. I do this a lot, and I use something from this the modes menu. I used a soft light layer. I have a lot of students who really like that option. I tend to find it a little overdone, and so I just reduce the opacity of it until it feels right to me. Okay, I can do pretty much the same thing with my contrast adjustment, but sometimes that soft light layer can be useful too. Now, the next step is to get rid of the noise, and I'm noticing it more than anywhere else right here in the bottom right and up in the top left of the photo. And if I zoom in, you'll be able to see exactly what I mean. There's a lot of color noise in this image, and there's some noise that I can definitely get rid of pretty easily. So, in order to get rid of noise, I'm going to go ahead and flatten these layers, create a new layer, Everything I do is on a new layer. And then I'm going to use filter, noise, and reduce noise. And there's my little boat. I want to make sure I can see the bottom right-hand corner of my scene and my boat, because as I adjust the strength here, I need to be able to see that that main point of interest, because if I overdo it, I can end up with a sort of weird-looking scene, so I have to be careful about that. I don't need that much noise reduction for the standard noise. What I really need to do is reduce the color noise. Let me zoom in to the corner over here so you can see that noise again. Here's the noise before I've reduced anything. And there's the difference that strength adjustment made. But look what happens when I reduce the color noise. You see how the color noise just went away almost completely? You can see what happens when I show the preview and the original image. It's a huge difference. So noise, it's an easy thing to clean up. If it's color noise, it's one slider. If it's standard noise, it's the other slider. Works really nicely. And the difference, even in a small-sized image, I suspect it's a little bit hard to see in a Hangout, but the difference on a monitor and in a print is absolutely huge. And then finally, the last thing I'm going to do is zoom in, and I'm going to clean up this spot. It's very distracting. It's another distraction that, to me, really stands out in the image. And I'm just using the clone tool, the spot healing tool, actually. And then this is the kind of thing where you can easily scoot around, find them. It's so easy to get rid of little spots like that. Okay, and then I go back to my original image. And if you take a look at the original image, back when I first opened it, and then take a look at the change, the difference here is the difference between something that looks like you had a great idea, you knew what you wanted, but you didn't follow through to really put the finishing touches on the image, and a photo that I'd be proud to hang in my home. So I think that one of the biggest things that I find is important in photography is to take the image all the way through the process. Get out there, think it through in the field. A lot of times I have a pretty solid idea of what I'm looking for before I even press the shutter release. And then to be able to take it into Photoshop afterwards and do the processing, the same thing that I would have done in the darkroom a few years ago. Now I can do it in my digital darkroom, and I can hit the save button, and you know, I don't have to hang out in the darkroom for hours and leave my children neglected in the other room. So I think there's a complete process that we should be following through on from beginning to end.
Awesome. Varina, that was great. I really appreciate you citing out some of those elements and then using really simple techniques to, like we said, coax what the photographer, we think, had the idea of in the first place, which is really great. You know, something I noticed was, I think that was a fabulous image. I think it was taken with a smartphone, actually.
Really?
You can look at the EXIF information, and I think it was a Motorola smartphone. So really fantastic job with, it just goes, the equipment doesn't matter. The idea was there and well executed, so.
Yeah, and I think that's a really important point you bring up. I think it's hugely important to point that out. I have so many students come to me and say, you know, what equipment should I get? What gear do I need? I have this camera. Do I need a better camera? And I tell them again and again, don't spend your money on new equipment until you know why you need new equipment. Spend your money. If you must spend money, spend it on knowledge. Find ways to learn. You know, take a workshop. Take a course. Join the Arcanum, you know, whatever it is. But it's knowledge that matters far more than your equipment. So there you go. I'm happy to prove my own point, but there it is.
Awesome. Okay. Dave, are you ready to get in the batter's box?
Yes, sir.
All right.
So I got to give props to Trey. If he really went and looked at every single photo, then good for you, because I used a very scientific method. I was in the Google Plus page, and I literally went like this with my mouse and went, and it stopped. And I went, what's this one? And I'm like, oh, I like that. So that was my very interesting way. Now, I got to say, I know we're supposed to critique one photo, but I have to show you this one other photo because I love this for two reasons. First of all, the guy's name, because I don't know how you can not share a photo with a guy's name like Johnny West.
I mean, oh, yes.
So this I love. There's nothing I would change about it, but this is my style. I love the fact that instead of looking at Photoshop as a necessary evil to, you know, adjust a few things, he went into this thinking, I'm going to use Photoshop as part of the creative process and actually combine multiple images of the same person. And I think that's fantastic. I love when people don't look at Photoshop as simply a tool to fix things, but as a way that you can add to your creative toolbox. So you're embracing Photoshop, and I think that's a great thing. I'm always waving the flag of embrace Photoshop. But I just wanted to show that because I thought it was cool.
I saw that photo too. I liked it a lot. I call that photo another Tuesday night at Frederick Van Johnson's house.
So this is the photo that I did actually look at three or four, but this is the one that really caught my attention. It's by Amy Wurdock, and it was on the Google Plus page, and there were a couple things about this that I really appreciated, and I think as we're going to talk about multiple times throughout critiques, a big part of photography is seeing opportunities, and I thought this was great that someone actually saw this possibility and went, hey, if these two guys stood there in front of this big window, there can be just enough light to light up their faces a little bit, but it's still kind of a silhouette. And that's one of the things I really liked about this, is that I think silhouette photos are interesting, but the danger with a silhouette is that you might not be able to recognize the person. If I'm assuming this is going to be some kind of a portrait or maybe in an album, I think it's important that you still are able to tell who it is. So if you look on his face and both faces, there's just enough light. So the photographer got them to look in just enough to see a bit of light on them. So I thought that was a really good decision to do that, because it would have been much harder after the fact to try to edit that to get to that result. So as much as I embrace Photoshop, I'm also lazy, so I don't want to take time to do things if I don't need to. So I thought that was great. I also thought it was interesting that the background information, you can kind of see it, but it's not in focus enough to really be a distraction. Now, having said that, I think the couple of things that I would have tried to do a little bit differently is, if the possibility existed, is to maybe use a different lens or focal length, because two things jump out at me. One of them is, I love when someone uses the elements around to make kind of a natural frame, but it doesn't work very well if that frame has kind of a curved feel to it. And that, to me, suggests that maybe the lens was a little bit wider instead of longer, so that if, you know, even if it meant standing a little bit further back and using a longer lens would make everything a little more square, and also would maybe drop the things, the depth of field might be a little bit more. Now, given enough time, of course, we could do that kind of thing in Photoshop. I'm not going to in this case, but here's what I'm talking about, is that I just drew a couple of straight lines to go show that some of it's straight, but this part up here to me is where the distracting element comes in, because I'd like that to be straighter. I experimented with cropping it out completely, but I didn't like it as much. I really like that natural kind of border that happens, but again, would prefer if it was straight. Now, I use Photoshop, although what I'm going to show here could, the first part could easily be done in Lightroom as well, because one of the things that I've discovered, as much as I spend my time teaching Photoshop, is that it's a whole lot easier to use some of the adjustments in Camera Raw or Lightroom than Photoshop. So, for example, to try to fix some of these things in Photoshop would be more difficult. So if I had the original file, which I don't, I just copied and pasted this, if it was my camera, it would have been a RAW file, but you can also do it with JPEG. One of the things that's, I'm using Photoshop CC here, and one of the additions that I absolutely love, because I live as much in Camera Raw as I do in Photoshop, is the fact that one of the options now is I can actually access Camera Raw as a filter on a layer-by-layer basis. And this is a really exciting possibility because you might be working on a collage or a composite with several layers, and now you have the option of applying it as a filter. Now, personally, I'm the evangelist of the non-destructive workflow, so I'm always suggesting that we try and keep everything as editable as possible. So anytime I go to do a filter, my first option or first step is to choose Convert for Smart Filters. That converts this layer into a smart object, which in this case, most importantly, means when I go to edit it in the Camera Raw filter, I'll be able to continue to edit it even as I work on it. So now I can go to the Camera Raw filter, and that just basically jumps into what looks just like Camera Raw, because it basically is, except it's just missing a couple of elements that aren't there because, for example, normally down at the bottom you can use workflow options to pick the file size and so on. Well, we don't need to do that because we already have the file open. So I have my clipping warnings turned on, so you can see there's a bit of a clipping warning happening in the black. In this case, I'm not so worried about that because, again, it's trying to have that kind of silhouette feel. But what I would like to try to do is see if Camera Raw can help with some of this distortion. And that ability is in here. And one of the things that's really interesting about Camera Raw is it actually has a database of lenses. So when you open a photograph in Camera Raw, it will make its best attempt to say this was taken with a whatever it is, you know, 24 to 70 lens or whatever, and then make adjustments accordingly. So this part here is fairly new, the last version or so of Camera Raw, but there's in earlier versions there's still that the option to go in and make that adjustment. But if I go in and say, can you make an automatic adjustment here, you'll see that it's just doing a little bit of work on now. It's a little straighter than it was before. It's still a slight curve to it, so I also have the option of just manually going in and just doing a little tiny bit of distortion because I'm trying to get that as straight as I possibly can. So once I've done that, I click OK, and here's the smart part of the smart filter is it actually shows up in the layers panel. And part of the reason for doing this is a lot of people, I think of this whole non-destructive thing as in case I need to change my mind, which is part of it, but I have the feeling that I'm not the only one that's ever had this happen where you're experimenting on a photograph, you do a bunch of things, and you save it as a JPEG, and then you come back 2 months later and go, how on earth did I do that? Right? Because you were just trying a bunch of things. So I always now save a PSD file, which is my master copy, that among other things reminds me, oh yeah, I did the Camera Raw filter. What did I do? Well, I can double click and it will tell me what I did. I just have to go back and look at the various settings. I also have the ability to turn that on or off. You can see how that is making just that little adjustment. If we turn my little guides back on now, you see it's much closer to that kind of straightness that I want. And I have a couple of options here. There's a little part at the top that you can see a bit of white sneaking in there, so I could crop it a little bit. Or one of the downsides to using a smart object, and I call it a downside because some people view it that way, I personally don't. I tend to do all my cloning, healing, etc. on a separate layer anyway, just in case. So in this case I would add a blank layer, and now I can use the spot healing brush and just go along and kind of feel, okay, so the spot healing didn't work, so let's try the patch tool. That's one of the nice things about having more than one option. The patch tool now has an option called Content Aware, which is fantastic, especially because it now allows you to sample all layers. So now I can move it to a different spot and it fixes the problem, and now I've got that little bit on that separate little layer there. And as I said, I like the fact that there's the silhouette with a little bit of the lighter part on their faces, but here's one of the things that I like about using this Camera Raw filter is a lot of people have discovered the hard way that no matter what you do, even if you go through some calibration, things will tend to print a little darker than it appears on your screen. And I realized a few years ago that part of the problem was that there's nothing wrong with my printer. My monitor's too bright. Most of us have our monitors cranked up really bright to view the internet, but that means if we're judging things visually, they tend throws us off a bit. So I might print this and look at it at the print and go, oh, it's not quite what I had in mind. So this gives me the ability now to come back here and say, maybe I do want to push the exposure and just open up the blacks just a little tiny bit and then click OK. So this is one of the other advantages of working non-destructively. Now you'll notice that that patch layer doesn't update, so we'd have to redo that part. But at least the ability to have that camera raw filter ability for me is a big plus. And by the way, if you didn't know, smart filters also have their own mask, so if there was parts of it that you wanted to take away, you'd have that ability. So I'm a big proponent of working non-destructively so that you can continue to edit even after you've printed it. So I would save this as a PSD file and save a copy as a JPEG to send to my lab or do whatever I wanted, knowing that I still have this master copy to come back to. So that's kind of the approach that I take when I'm working on something.
Right on. Dave, that was great. I really appreciate you citing some of the items you wanted to go after and then using very simple techniques and tools that are available in Lightroom and Photoshop and so forth just to improve and coax out wonderful beauty out of these images. It's great. Everybody did such a great job. I really appreciate it. The chat room is going absolutely nuts. I think people are really enjoying it.
Can I say one other, since I still have the microphone? Rick Sammon is absolutely famous for his Sammonisms, which are all the expressions that he's known for. So I'm trying to, I want to be Rick Sammon when I grow up, so I've started my own now in the Photoshop world. So I say that the five forbidden fruits of Photoshop are merge, flatten, erase, delete, and erase, delete, merge, flatten, rasterize. So those are the things. If you do that, you're going to cause yourself more trouble. I just even made Rick run away when I said that. So
he did. He got up and left.
Oh, he's got his Rick Sammonisms T-shirt.
Oh, right on. Yeah, that's a great pearl of wisdom there. I like it. Very good. All right.
You want me to go now, Pete?
Absolutely.
That was awesome, by the way. I was watching the chat while that was going on, and everyone just has amazing things to say about Varina, Rick, and Dave. I don't know if they'll say these same things about me. We'll see. By the way, I'm very sick. That's why I sound so terrible. But I'm fighting through it for you. So excuse my non-buttery smooth voice. By the way, speaking of buttery smooth, that last photo that Dave worked on, I call Wednesday night at Frederick Van Johnson's house. Okay. All right. I'm a screen share here. Let's get this going. Oh, I can't find my screen share button. What's up? Let me resize my window here. Having some technical difficulties. Let me see here. Here we go, screen share, and then go pick this one.
You've never had a Hangout before, Trey. It's your first time, right?
Yeah, I don't know what is going on. Okay, my window resized. I couldn't find the screen share button. Okay, so I'm actually not critiquing this photo. I'm going to show you some that I found that I will not critique. And one reason I'm not critiquing some of these is because they're just too good. You know what I mean? They're just amazing. So this one is by Alessio Moradi, and this is this awesome place in Iceland, and he just knocked it out of the park. I think it's unbelievable. Look at the way these rocks look so nice and green and yellowy and mysterious. It's good that he has nice blacks in here. They don't detract. The sky looks great. All the colors are balanced. It's not oversaturated. It's well composed. There's green all the way around here that opens up into the blue sky, and there's water transitioning you into the blue sky. It's just great. It's great. Here's another one I didn't choose to process because, again, I just can't, or to fix or critique because it's just too good. This is from Poliana Devane, it's such a cool photo, isn't it? I mean, if I were to say anything about it, it's a minor thing, but maybe a little more room on top. Some of those buildings are just creeping up to the top too much. A little more breathing room would be good, but just a really cool photo. Here's another one I'm not critiquing from Chuck Palmer because it's just too good again. You know, beautiful depth of field. It's great. Once you discover this little trick, I guess when you have a good lens and you can shoot at what, f1.4, let's see if we can see the photo details here. It doesn't really say. It must have gotten stripped out in processing, but I imagine it's f1.4 or 1.8 or something. And it's just such a fun treat to walk around and find nice little shapes and with nice colors and bokeh area. It's just an endless tableau for you to work with that kind of lens. So that's a really good shot there, Chuck Palmer. Here's another one I'm not critiquing from Sean Allen. It's a great photo. It's so cool. In fact, in the description, if you want to see how he did it, if you read through all the posts, people wanted to get their stuff critiqued. He put a really long description of how he used an ND filter to make this happen. So yeah. In fact, I'll make a little aside here about the Arcanum and say, like, when you're in there, you're going to learn as much from your fellow apprentices as you do your master. Because people are going to come in with their own backgrounds and their own techniques, so that'll be sort of a hidden benefit, I think, that people discover. Here's another one I'm not going to critique because it's too good. This is from Angela Pan. She's a great photographer, and I mean, we could pick any one of her photos. They're all amazing, and she's actually an example of someone that we want to fast track in to be a master in the next round, because we're just completely overloaded with apprentices, and we got to get more masters. So we're taking kind of this first group through a test run, but then we want to fast track. People like Angela and many others that have signed up already. We're just overloaded. But here's the one that we will critique. We finally arrive at our quarry. This is from Hugh Ferguson. And I'm super excited to like talk about this one because I see this problem, or this series of problems, over and over and over again with kind of HDR-ish type shots, which I guess this falls into the category of. And, you know, maybe if I can say a few things that'll keep people from making the mistakes in the future. And sometimes you just don't see it. But when someone points it out, then you'll see it. All right. So let me unscreen share that and come back and come to my Lightroom here. Come into this thing. So I'm going to unscreen share this. You'll see me for a moment. Then I'm going to screen share my whole desktop here. Okay, now we're on. Okay, so Pete, if you can't see my Lightroom, just pipe up.
Yeah, you're good.
Good, okay. So what I've done is I've just kind of brought this right into Lightroom. I just clipped it off the internet. I stole your photo here, Hugh. Sorry about that, but it's all for the good forces of the world. Let me talk about what I don't like about this photo, and this is the same thing as Rick said, of course. This is just totally subjective. You know, everyone has their own style, and if you're going for a certain style that doesn't agree with what I'm saying, that's fine. I'm just telling you what I would do, all right? So there's a lot of, like, heaviness and blackness mixed into the colors, generally. If you look here at the sky, this is a really good example. Do you see how the sky on the very top and top left is, like, this dark black gray blue? It's, you know, as Ronald Chevalier would say, it is just not believable. There is a problem that happens with HDR in that when you process your photo in HDR, it actually doesn't know the difference between the sky and the ground, and it gets it all fairly evenly matched. But generally, your sky, at least when the sun is up, should be at least, you know, 20, 30, 50% brighter than the ground, and that's not what's happened here. And also the idea that you can have, like, these black blue skies in such close proximity to the sun is also not quite believable. So when the brain sees this and it tries to say, like, okay, is this realistic? Is this something I can believe in? When you see this kind of extreme color gradation from the sun all the way to black so quickly, it really makes you pause and the brain can reject it right away. There's a few other things here that I'll talk about and then try to fix too. By the way, this is going to be very difficult to fix because now it's just a JPEG. I would actually enjoy starting over if I had the raw files and make it totally new. So we're pretty late in the game, and this photo has already been overworked. to the point where we may not be able to recover much, but we'll do just a few things, okay? Maybe I'll show you a few light roomy tricks here as well. But if you look at the water here, the water right underneath the sun is like this black blue. It's also a little saturated in a strange way. It's kind of ghosted. This happens with water in HDR because it's combining multiple shots, and it kind of makes the water kind of ghosty and a little bit gray, dirty, so it doesn't feel that great. Also, up here on these edges of things, they're like super black, like the edge of this old mill, these little stone finements that are coming off the top. They're just too inky black, a little bit jarring, okay? So let's get started here in Lightroom, and we'll just make a few adjustments. One of the things, great things in Lightroom is a thing called blacks. So if we pull this up, it'll take a lot of those black areas and just brighten up the whole shoot and match, which makes it feel better, okay? And you notice as I do that, it almost feels more colorful. But don't worry, we're going to tone that down. You don't want the whole thing saturated. I think it's okay to fully saturate one color, but if you fully saturate like blues, yellows, greens, reds, if you do too much, then the eye just has nowhere to take a break. Okay, excuse me. I feel a cough. Okay. So here we go. Let's lighten up the sky here, all right? We're going to do this with the gradient tool. Actually, it's not called gradient tool. It's called the graduated filter tool, sorry. But it's effectively the same thing. So I pick that, and then let's zero this out. I'm going to pull down across the sky, okay? And we're just going to brighten up everything up there so it's not quite so dingy. All right, so we can do that by pulling up the shadows, by increasing the exposure a little bit. So this is really bringing up the sky. You see that it just feels a little bit better. But it's also getting a little bit purpley blue or something, so we'll drop down the saturation. There we go. Good, so that's looking better already. All right, so we'll close this. Now let's recrop it a little bit, okay? And if you have trouble in composition, by the way, I don't think the composition on this is terribly bad at all. I think it's pretty good. But if you're just someone that has great trouble composing, when you're in Lightroom and cropping, I recommend you go in and turn off the rule of thirds and turn on the rule of golden ratio. And that's here under Tools, Crop Guide Overlay, Golden Ratio, okay? And then you can move it in a little bit. Let's get that sun just closer along one of those lines of phi, all right? Now, let's cut off a little bit more of the sky because you're not really telling more of the story by showing more of the sky. Let's just bring that down a little bit. Let's tighten up the bottom. I would totally agree with what Rick says. I love this sort of cinematic crop because it just feels more Ben-Hur, more epic. I just love it. So the ground has sort of a strange color, series of colors, doesn't it? Let's warm it up a little bit. So we can warm it up. We'll pick the graduated filter thing again, slide it up here, just on the ground part. Okay, let's move it down just a little bit. And then we can warm it up here with temperature. So if you go to temperature, you can warm it up. So it feels more like a warmer color than just a mishmash of colors. We could even brighten it a little bit like the sun is hitting it. You can decide, too, with clarity, do you want it super sharp or super soft? I don't think all parts of your photo should be equally soft or hard. So I'm going to soften that a little bit. Maybe drop down the saturation a little bit more, increase the temperature a little bit more. Good. Now let's try to fix some of these just inky black spots that are in there, because there's another no-no about shooting with a blue sky, and HDR will do this, is you'll have black clouds. And it's okay to have black clouds. If it's all clouds, then it's something like intensely stormy, but it's just really rare to see blue skies and black clouds. That's another kind of warning sign to your brain. So we're going to pick this tool, all right? This is the adjustment brush, all right? And then we'll kind of change the size of the brush there with the right and left bracket keys. And I'm kind of painting over it now. Nothing's happening. I'm just getting my space that I know I want. And then I'll go over here and increase the shadows. So you see that cloud getting a little brighter. Maybe increase the exposure a little bit. And I still have my same tool, so I can go around to other things that are too dark and just kind of keep painting over that. You're just bringing the light back through those clouds. You're letting the sun get through them like it really probably was. But that one didn't look so good. Let me make the brush a little bit bigger. Brush through here. There we go. Here's a dark cloud here. We'll brush through there. That one looks good. So let's make another one, and let's fix the same thing down here on the water. because this water is kind of crazy black, okay? So we'll start by increasing the exposure and the shadows a little bit just so we can see what we're doing. And you click, and here's a little mini hint, by the way. If you click and you're like having trouble like because your line is all over the place, you're going up and down, it looks crazy. If you hold down the shift button as you draw, it makes sure that it goes straight across, even if you're moving it up and down. So that's a nice way to make a nice horizontal line there. All right. Make another new one. We'll brighten up underneath it a little bit. Same kind of thing. Maybe not quite as bright because we're getting a little closer down to the bright area. If you could just go straight across, you might get a little bit of horizontal banding, but it's okay because it's kind of believable in this situation. And if I had an infinite time and patience, what I would also do is all these super black areas down in here, I would go lighten those up. But I feel like they're just too far gone and too inky to be fixed at this point. That's something that could be fixed earlier in the processing. Okay, so we'll look at a before and after. So that's the before, or it's sort of dark and brooding. And then we go to this one, the final one. It's just brighter and happier and I think more believable and more pleasant to look at. Okay. All right, so let me unscreen share here. Okay. Is that good, Pete? Did that come through loud and clear?
Yeah, I think so. That was really good. Again, I really appreciate everybody taking the time to pick out two or three points and then laser precision going in there and using simple techniques to coax that beauty out of the photograph. I really love it. So thank you very much.
Awesome. I see a thing in chat there that Rick wanted to say something about that photo. Go for it, Rick. You might be muted, by the way, Rick, so you can go unmute yourself up at the top.
So, there you go.
Yeah, you're live. Go.
Can we get that photo back?
Absolutely. Let me pull it back here.
I love that photo, and I know we're all limited, and I learned something from Dave and Marina and all you guys. So, I mean, this is like a ton of fun. And I know, you know, I looked at some of the comments, and one person said they want to see more critique and less post-processing. But today, you know, I think for what we do, maybe not a wedding photographer, you know, wedding photographers got to get it right in camera. We should try to get it right in camera. But, you know, for me, it's like 50-50. And I saw what Trey did on this picture. It was amazing. But I see a mistake that I've made here, and I still make it every once in a while. When you're shooting into the sun, your lens has to be so clean. Otherwise, you're going to get all those little dust spots. You know, they're going to look like blobs in your picture. The idea is it's a simple technique, but rather than just cleaning your lens like this, start from the middle and rub outward like that and try to get rid of the dust. It's impossible to get rid of the dust because it sticks to the lens. So if you see something like this, an awesome scene like this, an awesome shot, try to take a couple of shots, clean your lens, take some more shots.
Yeah, that's a good point. And actually, when you were talking about the sun, I thought there's one other thing he could have done is, you know, if he made his f-stop like f16, f20, he could have got that little starburst effect, and that's always a winner when you get that thing going. Yeah. All right, Pete, anything else? We're going to wrap it up and say our sad goodbyes?
Absolutely, yep. Yeah, we're just about an hour in, so I really appreciate everybody's time. And once again, I really want to put a shout-out to everybody that's already signed up for the Arcanum. And, of course, everyone else that's submitted a photo for this event. I thought it was a lot more fun than I thought. It was great. It totally exceeded my expectations.
What do you mean we're a fun group?
Yeah. Well, no, I don't mean it that way. I just mean that it's so great. I learned so many things just in this short period of time, and it's always great. There's just nothing better than some good, honest, and candid constructive criticism. And the fact that we can use some tools to coax some of that stuff out is even better. So I really appreciate it. I learned a lot. So thank you, guys. And again, thanks to everybody for really being so vulnerable and submitting these photos, knowing that it might be picked and talked about. And Rick, I think you made a great point. It's all subjective. And so, again, kudos to people that are able to get out there, put themselves out there and share and open themselves up. That's what life's about. I think you get more from it. So that's it. That's all I have to say. So I think we can wrap it up, Trey.
Yes, wrap it up. We can just kind of wave goodbye. Thanks, yeah. Varina and Rick and Dave. You guys are awesome.
Yeah.
Okay. And, so friends, we'll see you.
Thanks for having us.
You all bet, right. And we'll see you guys next time. And thanks everyone for watching. Yes. And thanks, Pete, for putting it all together and all your hard work on the back end.
I love it. Thank you. All right, good.
Cool. All right. Bye, guys. See ya.
Good night.